I wait patiently for you, Lord. And he turned to me and he heard my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit and out of the muck and the mire. And he set my feet upon a rock and gave me a firm place to stand. He put a new song in my mouth and a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear the Lord and put their trust in him. But blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, who does not look to the proud, to those who turn aside to false gods. Many, Lord my God, are the wonders you have done. The things you have planned for us, none can compare with you. Were I to speak and tell of your deeds, they would be too many to declare. Then I said, here I am. I have come. I desire to do your will, my God, for your law is in my heart. Oh, let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we can just picture the psalmist as he sat, Lord, and was just overwhelmed by your presence. May we this morning, Lord, as we too are overwhelmed, Lord, about the goodness and the glory of God in this place. May all that we do, think, or say, Lord, may it be pleasing unto you. May we glorify you in your presence this morning, upon this place. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. And amen. And my, what a precious time to come. Thank you, Julie, for bringing us into the ministry of God's holy word. We have announcements before we go into our worship hour this morning. Yes, brother?
Our annual congregational meeting will be next week, the 5th at 11:30, immediately following Sunday school.
Okay, thank you. Others? If we have none, take out your hymn book. And Sister Jane Murphy just loved this hymn here. Of course, she loved many of them, and it's hard to know which one is your favorite. And I'm kind of like a few other beautiful people says, my favorite's the one I'm singing at the time. So I can get to tell me the story of Jesus. Sister Julie, bring us in. Okay, I'm sorry. Oh, the Bears. Thank you. Did not see.
The one is from Jerry Hauser. It is a friend of mine, Devin Hauser. I'm pretty sure Miranda remembers him. They own a dairy farm.
Yeah, out next to him.
Yeah.
Red House.
Yeah. He was in a farming accident the other day, they said. And Devin says that he has a very long road recovery. There's not much they can do right now. It's all in God's hands. So I just thought it would be nice to send them.
Yeah, he's 83, 84.
He looks really good. I've seen him at Buckley Festival because his son is one of the ag teachers at Preston High. And he was there, and his daughter shows at Buckley Festival, and him and his wife looked really good. But let's just keep them up with our prayers. He has some broken bones in his jaw area and a collapsed lung, and I can't remember what else.
Yeah, he was trying to start a tractor with a screwdriver randomly. Yeah. So. Sister?
My bear is for Lisa Lohman. She is the daughter-in-law of some good friends at the farmer's market. She was diagnosed on Wednesday with a very aggressive form of breast cancer, and they started chemo on Thursday.
Okay. All right. Thanks, Kat. Yeah. Let us stand and worship in song. Hymn number 205. Tell me the story of Jesus. Sister Julie.
Thank you.
And as we, as a body of believers, come before God now in prayer, do you ever have to give a deep sigh? Maybe at the end of whatever, just fill in the blank, but you just wanted to come before God. And many times, probably each one of us can say, man, there's just so much. But then you sigh and you get that fresh relief. I believe we need to do that every time we come to God in prayer, to know that it's not because of me, this flesh. I have to be reminded too. And Sister Arlene said a doctor did a miracle this week and thought it was him. No. So let us just bow before our God in a humble prayer. Do we have praises before we go into our prayer together? Arlene.
If I can say this, truly there was a miracle in Cleveland this week. The doctor literally took baby Ben out of its mom, fixed a problem, put the baby back, and things worked very well. The family, of course, is on cloud nine and thanking God for the miracle. They do ask that we continue to pray that infection does not set in and cause a problem that way. But baby and mama are doing terrific. Thank you all.
You're welcome. It's 6 months old. Praise.
She's 6 months long, yeah.
Yeah, in the womb. Yeah, thank you.
Well, she neglected to tell you there was 37 people besides mama and baby in the operating room.
Awesome.
Everybody had a job to do.
And they did.
Before, you know, so it's
thanks. Thanks.
I have two requests. My granddaughter, great-granddaughter, I guess she is, Laura, husband is having medical problems and will probably have to have some surgery done. So keep Laura and Donovan in your prayers. Gary Darnell, which some of you may know, had what they call Widowmaker's heart attack the other week. They did CPR on him. His lungs are bruised, so that means they probably used the paddles to bring him back. And they brought him back three times. And he is still in the hospital and is doing fair.
Okay. Sister Kathy.
A praise. Just his whole family ended up with COVID. But they're all on the mend and doing well, and I think this week we'll get back to a normal. We'll see. And I'd also like to add Bob and Ruth Howdershout. They're our next door neighbors. Bob had a massive stroke and is in the hospital. We'll have to go to rehab when he's able to be released from the hospital. And then sometime Wednesday evening, Ruth fell outside and had to drag herself into the house. And laid on her living room floor until Thursday when somebody realized something wasn't right. She's in the hospital now as well. So just remember them. They're both in their 80s.
Okay. Yes, Beth.
Sadie and I were going to the doctor on Tuesday, and we came up on the accident on 68. I saw that accident, so there's no way if there's anybody coming out of that vehicle. But praise God, it was a girl and her boyfriend and friend. The girl is Kara Cartwright. Her mom is Erica Foreman, used to be Erica Belanger. All she come out of there was with a broken pelvis and some sutures in her elbows. I can't remember the boy's name, but can you keep her in your prayers? Because she says she is having a very rough time. She keeps getting the flashbacks of getting hit from behind, and it really scares her, and she just cries. And the two boys walked away with no broken bones that were in the front seat. So praise God for that.
Amen. Thanks, Ben.
What was her name? Kara Cartwright. But I can't remember the boys' names.
Yes, Sharon.
Just remember Jerry's cousin, Debbie, her husband, Fuzzy, passed away last Sunday morning.
Okay. All right.
So Debbie needs lots of prayers.
All right, thanks. Sis, you have a hand?
Yeah, just prayers for Wells. God knows what.
Amen.
The band will be traveling to ACC next week for their competition, so I'll be going with the band. So just track me.
We will.
unspoken requests, unspoken praises within your heart. Sister Julie. Our Father in heaven, Lord, what precious times that you allow us here at Salem to grasp, Lord, and to remember as you're in this place, Lord. Lord, one day your son Jesus taught his disciples and the one around that there's enough trouble today for you and for them. But then he said, but sufficient is his Father's word for all. Thank you, Lord, that he taught us this day, this present moment. Oh, he shared with us about tomorrow, but nowhere does he ever teach our worries of tomorrow. So, Lord, this morning, may we hold to that sufficient is his grace for this moment in time. We thank you, Lord, for the ones who have lifted up loved ones, even unborn children, Lord, are still in the womb, but they're still a child to the parents and to us and to you. Oh, it's a fearful place in the world we live today, Lord, for innocent little children in the mother's womb. And Lord, protect them, our Father. Protect them from evil, hatred, fear. But we know, Lord, and your word teaches and it is truth. Should they leave the womb, before life, they're in your son's holy arms. Thank you for that promise. Thank you for family, Lord. As each one lifted up a family member, lift of a hand for a loved one who doesn't know Jesus or a neighbor. And that list goes on, Lord. And the praises filter down through time. Accidents, Lord, that are change a life in the twinkling of an eye. Father, this morning, just what a privilege to just gather around your holy throne, Lord, and just bow and lay it all, Lord, at your son's feet. So, Lord, give us that fresh breath. Give us that assurance that many times, Lord, the world tries to rob and steal. And Lord, may we just have a desire within our heart that your grace is sufficient. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. Someone have an offertorial thought? You know, there's many reasons and to give. There's many righteous reasons and there's some wrong reasons. We don't take God's word that if we give, he'll give back in the same way. It's just not that way. But over time, and time, you know, they say time's a great teacher, but we tend to forget. Back up. I tend to forget. But there's a lot I remember. Same with each and every one of you. I give Phyllis a hug this morning. I said, "My, you're getting short." Aren't we all? But as we give, may we give, and we do, and I give my thanks, and God gives his blessings. But let's give for the right reasons, and the right reasons only, and we do. So with that, I say thank you, as the ushers come forward once more to give to the Lord. Sister. Let us stand together. And Lord, what a privilege just to worship you in giving. Receive now our Father in our precious name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. You may be seated.
tell you a little story on I Know a Man. My son spent 20 years in the Air Force. And when he retired after 20 years, Burlington County, New Jersey, 911 called him 1 week after his retirement. He retired as a shirt, and a shirt is somebody that gets things done. And 911 called him, said, "Do you want a job running 911? And he took it. He called me, said, "Dad, I got hired. I run 911 in Burlington County, New Jersey." I said, "What do you know about 911? He said, "Nothing. But I know a man who can." Isn't that awesome? As they sang that song, and how many times each one of you can relate. What do I do? Someone asked me the other day. Seriously. He said, I'm thinking about buying a business. He was a businessman, and he wanted to grow his business. He said, "What do you think?" I said, "I think you need to talk to the man who knows." And we did. How precious. Take out your Bibles, and I don't know if forgotten is the proper word, but Lamentations. Remember, my chapter in the Bible that I love is Leviticus. Simply because Leviticus is a book in order. If you like things in order, you'll love Leviticus, because it tells you, when you stop at night, this is how I want you to camp. When you get up in the morning, this is how I want you to... doesn't leave. Someone said, "Oh, I just wish God would speak to me audible." And my words is always, He does. Right there. But Leviticus sure is a book for our time. And I've entitled today's message, "The Foundation of Hope." And if our hope, and I'll get into that a little bit in the message, isn't based upon a foundation of the Word, it'll be short-lived. But listen for me now, or you can follow along. Probably Jeremiah is speaking here, and he looks around at the once great city, and this is what he penned for us. It's Leviticus, just a little short book, 5 chapters in it. But we're going to do Leviticus 3, starting with verse 19, and just read over to 26. And it starts out him looking over the city, and see what happens. And this is where each and every one of us, Lord. Scripture says He works in mysterious ways, but sometimes He just works right directly to the heart. Leviticus 3:19, Jeremiah, picture him now as he's had just walked through a city, and he goes into maybe a little dark room that's been tattered and torn, and he takes out his quill, and he begins to write, and this is what he writes. "I remembered my afflictions and my wanderings, the bitterness and the gall. I well remember them, and my soul is downcast within me." And then he looks at his heart. "Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for His compassions never fail. They are new every morning, for great is your thankfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion, and therefore I will wait for him. The Lord is good to, to those whose hope is in him. To the one who seeks him, it is good to wait patiently for the salvation of the Lord. Will you pray with me? Our Father in heaven, what precious moments, Lord, when we come together, Lord, to worship, to give, to pray. And now we come, Lord, just to open your word. And may the Holy Spirit, Lord, just move freely within this place. May there be an open and tender heart, Lord, in each pew. May our minds, Lord, not wander to tomorrow or travel back to yesterday. Lord, may we just at this moment in time allow you, through the presence of Jesus and the Holy Spirit, speak to us, Lord. May my weakness show forth your mighty strength. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. As Jeremiah looks over the once great city, he begins by talking about Jerusalem as Jerusalem being a widow who now sits alone in her grief. And then Isaiah even speaks about the once great nation, once a prince among nations, but now is reaping the harvest. People used to be treated with respect and honor and dignity. And now God's people find no security. They find no rest. Now there's neither land around them, brick upon brick, or even homes. So Jeremiah begins to do a great contrast between the past and the future. And we all do that occasionally. We all sometimes say, I remember, and there's nothing the matter with remembrance, but I'm going to just leave that at that. But the temple, once filled full of people and worshipers, now lay empty. The priest who used to lead the people in worship as they would come in with their flowing robes, and now they are left just looking around and sighing. Young women who used to have a joyful part in playing of the instruments and coming in and bringing joy to the religious feast. Now they are stunned in silence as they sit along the road, the princes and the political leaders who once lived in the community and had respect, and now they are rummaging through garbage just to find enough to feed them and their family just for that day. And they're hunted down like wild beast. And the enemy has come out on top, and he begins to look over the fallen city, and he just gloats over the weakness of the city. And then the ones in Jerusalem begin to ask the question, how did this happen? And then Jeremiah answers the question, because the Lord has made her to suffer for the multitude of her transgressions. Leviticus 1 verse 5, and I don't believe for a moment that statement is strong enough. Let me read it for you one more time. Because the Lord has made her suffer for the multitudes of her transgressions. No, he didn't. He made him to suffer because of their rebellion against him. We say the prayer, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, from our rebellion against you. As the ones looked around, they said, Babylon is our enemy. No, Babylon wasn't their enemy. God himself was their enemy. because they had rejected him to the very core. Time after time after time, Jeremiah went to the kings and he said, God loves you and he wants to bring you back. And even in the words today, as Jeremiah begins to say in chapter 5, bring us back, Lord. He's not saying bring us back to Jerusalem from Babylon. He's saying bring us back to you. Many times in life when we rebel as a body or as a believer, as individuals, we pray, oh, I just want to go back. But you're thinking going back to the building. Jeremiah says, what we got, we richly deserve. But you know that's not always the case. I'm sure there's some here. Jeremiah didn't deserve it. He was holding up God's truth. And as I began to read these words and put this together, I have today, too, I have a funeral. So I'll be leaving right after this. Cecil Sines died. I don't know if you knew that or not. But anyway, I have the privilege of having his funeral. And he died from cancer. But I began to remember back how you supported me in my cancer, but there was a couple that even came to my bed. And they said, what did you do that God is punishing you? Never even acknowledged the question. You see, they was wondering what he or she did sometimes to deserve that. And the only honest answer is nothing. What Job's friend asked him, Job, what'd you do? Why is God punishing you? We have to be careful. I have to be careful. There's an argument many times when we as individuals sometimes get puffed up. No. God is a holy God. He is an infinite God. And I can only say, and you've been there with me and through me, had I known that God was going to take my cancer out completely and replace it with the joy of his son Jesus, I'd have prayed, pray for more cancer. Jerusalem had been destroyed by the Babylonians and many of her people was killed and tortured and dragged away. And then the weeping prophet, the tears that are flowing from his eyes are just the message as the words himself. But the tears don't fully just represent falling from the eyes of Jeremiah. They're falling from the eyes of God. Remember Jesus as he's walking into Jerusalem and he looks over that vast city and the valley and the gates and the walls and he says, oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how I long to bring you to me as a hen gathereth her chicks and covers them from the safety of the world, that you would not let me. And Jesus weeps. I can't tell you how many times I know he was weeping for my rebellion. We say today that we've changed the name even of sin. And God has a tender spot in his heart for children.
He showed it all through his ministry through Jesus. Now, Jerusalem in its self-centeredness and God begins to mourn for his people and he weeps. We cry out and weep because of unmet longings. And tears shows that the heart is just engaged. But God too has a longing that once one of them tears falls upon you, boy, it just breaks your heart. I heard someone say one time, they're never going to be a slave to anyone. You see, America destroys that word, slave. I love being a slave for Jesus. I love it when he speaks to that chapel of my soul to do this or to do that, and what courage and what joy begins to flow from the very bowels of who we are, and we lift it up to him. We cry because we care. God cries because he cares. He weeps because he knows that there can be no grace without judgment. Many times in life, we go through different seasons. But then once we begin to rebel and fall away from God, and we get farther and farther, and you know, sin separates. And we can call it any other name. Remember the story of the rich man and Lazarus. Lazarus was outside the gate saying, oh, I just love to have the crumbs that fall from the rich man's table. And the dogs came and licked his sore. Most of you remember that story in Luke. They both died. The poor man went to Abraham's bosom. The rich man went to hell. And he said, I am here in this torment. Abraham, would you send Lazarus to come and just dip his finger in a cup of water and touch my tongue that I might be relieved from this pain and suffering? And Abraham says, can't do that. I won't do it, but I can if I wanted to. He said, there's a great gulf between the two, and you can't go to him and he can't come to you. You see, when we separate ourselves for so long, when that gulf begins to be fixed, and it's fixed at your last breath, no longer is mercy. Now it's judgment. And Jeremiah prays for his people. Just bring us back to you, God. Have you lost your hope lately? You know, hope can vanish in a blink of an eye. When a pro athlete, whatever he plays, has a serious injury, his hope's gone. Maybe when our hope is based upon something of the physical nature, whatever it might be. Maybe it's your health. Maybe it's your wealth. Maybe it's your mate. Whatever in life that holds you up that is not from God the Father, God the Son, or God the Holy Spirit. For whatever reason, when it don't come through, your sense of peace is gone. I know many in my cycle of life that are so dissatisfied with life, so dissatisfied, and there's many reasons for that. I'm not saying that every day you're going to be on this cloud that's just raising. There are things in life that'll rob your happiness. But I'm telling you, the Bible teaches that nothing this side of heaven can destroy your hope when it's based upon the word of a living God. Jeremiah says, I remember my afflictions and my wandering and the bitterness. Remember they put him in a well, throwed rocks at him, swore at him. But yet this I call to mind. You see, Jeremiah discovered the fulfillment of God's promise. Many times in life, we have to be careful to look, where is our hope based? You know, it's not really a secret, but we can call it that. But the secret of joy and peace, it involves finding something in this world that's not of the world. Jesus called it an eternal, unchanging, faithful God of the universe. He says, when my Father gives a promise, it's a promise fulfilled already. So when something we hope for becomes unfaithful, our dependence evaporates, doesn't it? There are occasional, maybe laps where we, for a moment of time, I've had them many times, but they're getting fewer. But I did find God is consistent with his promise. He never contradicts himself. Someone says, oh, the Bible, whatever. Don't argue. Just pray. God cannot cease to be who he is because of the circumstances around my life. He's still God regardless. Do I fully understand? No. But I know one thing. I trust God's faithfulness because his character doesn't depend upon me. Doesn't depend upon the world. Doesn't depend upon denominations. It depends upon him and him alone. So we need to be grounded in the fact the faithfulness of his character doesn't depend on our emotions, our thought, or our rapidly changing events. Apart from God, everything is changeable. But with God, when your hope is anchored to the foundation of truth, and I've come to learn, God does what he wants, when he wants it, every time. And he doesn't need my permission. And you only learn that through adversity. No other way. None. Faithfulness of God is where you need to ground your hope to. And when that happens, you'll have a joy that just refuses to let the world penetrate. Oh, you'll have bad days. You'll cry. You'll weep. But the song says, through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, what precious moments, Lord, when you remind us through your word, Lord, and through the Holy Spirit. It's okay to cry. It's okay to mourn. It's okay to be sorrowful. But Lord, it's not okay when we forget you. When we go our own way. Thank you, Lord, for some words that cut through this silliness of the world today. So Lord, may each one here be tethered to an unbreakable truth. That our hope is in you. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. Once more, take your hymn books as we sing again, and maybe again. Hymn number 44, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Sister Julie. And now, as our young acolytes
come forward. Again, I give my thanks unto you. May we now leave this place knowing it was good to be here, but more so than that, may we leave a little lighter. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, Lord, a young child, Lord, holds within her arms two monetary bags, Lord, that came into this sanctuary, Lord, as always, with just cotton and thread and color. But Lord, when they leave, because they've been lifted up unto your altar, Lord, through prayer and through belief, may they be a tool now, Lord, ordained for a purpose for you. To comfort the one, Lord, that sees, and as they behold the bear, Lord, may they look through it and behold you. And Father, boy, it was good to be here this morning in the house of the Lord. But may we know that you're always with us. So as we depart, may we depart with you in the chapel of our souls. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen.
Oh, Lord.